Good evening. I'm Craig Davis with the Chicago Public Library. We're very pleased to welcome you all here tonight to look into a contemporary take on the aftermath of the race riots in Chicago of 1919. On behalf of the Chicago Public Library, it has been a great pleasure to work with our colleagues at the Newberry Library on presenting several programs over the past few months dealing with this topic. And I would just like to remind you that with your Chicago Public Library card, which is free to all Chicago citizens, you can explore this topic and all other Chicago history topics at your Chicago Public Library in person or online. And now to launch tonight's program, I'm very pleased to welcome Liesl Olson, Director of Chicago Studies for the Newberry Library.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for being here. Thank you to Craig Davis and everybody here at the Harold Washington Library at such a wonderful venue to host us tonight and to collaborate with us on this series of programs around the history and legacy of the 1919 race riots. I work just up the street at the Newberry Library, which is also free and open to the public, so I encourage you to check out our resources there. I can't tell you how excited I am about tonight's program. I think everybody in the room knows that the Louder Than a Bomb Squad from Young Chicago Authors has produced some of the most vital, original, exhilarating, and necessary art to come out of Chicago. I'm looking at you there in the front row. And, you know, through their spoken word performances, they've engaged so many different topics and themes. Spoken word itself is a genre which has origins here in Chicago. People say spoken word was invented here in Chicago. So I want to tell you a little bit about how tonight's program with YCA is part of a larger series of conversations that have been taking place at venues across the city since last February. We've held an event almost every single month. So many people know, but perhaps many more people do not know, that the Chicago 1919 race riots were the most violent week in Chicago history, sparked by the death of Eugene Williams, an African-American teenager who was stoned and drowned to death for floating his raft over an invisible line into a whites-only Southside beach. The police refused to arrest the white man who stoned Williams, and the city, which was already seething with racial tensions, then erupted into arson, looting, and 38 deaths. 23 blacks died and 15 whites. 1919 marks a flashpoint in Chicago history, a moment when lines of segregation were reinforced between neighborhoods through restrictive housing covenants, selective policing, and unequal schools. One of the aims of our 1919 project is to underscore how segregation is not innate or natural or inevitable. Rather, it was invented and maintained through a powerful blend of violence, intimidation, and law. The Harold Washington Library is one of our 13 partners who were involved in the Chicago 1919 project. We were here at the Harold Washington talking about education in the city. This past July, we'll just focus on our most recent events. This past July saw some pretty incredible collaborative efforts across the city as we toured through neighborhoods in a massive bike ride, imagining what the city looked like in 1919. We also engaged in open-air debates at Bug House Square, which is the park right across the street from the Newberry, and we were fortunate to have our mayor, Lori Lightfoot, join us on the main stage. We have three more events after this one tonight. On September 24th at the Newberry, we explore the literature of Bronzeville with Ken Warren, Eve Ewing, and Nate Marshall. And of course, Eve and Nate are YCA alums. October 15th at the Chicago History Museum, we discuss policing and racial violence with Simon Balto and Robin Robinson. And on November 14th, our last program returns us to the DuSable, where we'll watch and discuss a new documentary produced by Barbara Allen called Red Summer, Winter Blues, which places Chicago's race riots in a national context. So you can go to our website right up here to register for these events. Again, they're all free. We also have on our website other events happening around the city, and I want to do a special shout out to historian Peter Cole, standing over there. Maybe you can raise your hand, Peter, who's leading, yes, who's doing some incredible work. He's leading a public arts initiative to actually create and implement markers in those 38 places around the city where deaths occurred in 1919. So definitely check out his project as well. There's a link to it on our website, and I know you've also got your own website, Peter. Now back to tonight. The spoken words that you're about to hear came out of weeks of work by these young performers, including an engagement with primary sources at the Newberry about the race riots. What are the imaginative dimensions that these performers have taken to this difficult history? How might language help us to measure the scope and range of experience, both the personal, the historical, and the collective? Like many people, I've been thinking about Toni Morrison this past week, and she said this: "We die. That may be the meaning of life, but we do language. That may be the measure of our lives." Leading and moderating this event for us tonight are two extraordinary poets whose language has certainly contributed to that measuring of life. So let me briefly introduce Kara Jackson and Patricia Fraser. Where are you guys in the room? Kara and Patricia, yes. That's what I'm talking about. Yes. They are both National Youth Poet Laureates. Patricia Fraser is a poet, filmmaker, and activist who was raised in Chicago's Bronzeville neighborhood. Patricia was a two-time finalist in Louder Than a Bomb team finals and winner of the 2016 Louder Than a Bomb Jordan Slam. Kara Jackson is a poet, musician, songwriter, singer, and all-around performing artist. Kara is a graduate of Oak Park River Forest High School and has performed frequently at venues all around Chicago. Let me also add that I heard from my colleague, Elizabeth Cummings, who does so much of the extraordinary work behind these events. She's a Smith alum. I heard that the two of you are maybe headed to Smith College in the fall. Congratulations to you both. Woo! Yeah. All right, and now my work is done. You guys can take it from here.
Okay. Okay, we're just gonna work with this. Hello. So my name is Nicholas. I'm from Oak Park and River Forest High School, which I just graduated from. So this first, thank you. So this first piece is entitled, "Chicago is My Granny Who Knows When to Beat Ass." When I was still growing into my tooth gap, I was spending another weekend at my grandparents' south side home, and Granny wanted her husband out of the basement for lunch. So I called my grandpa Mark from the upstairs kitchen, "Mark, Mark," and Granny heard and got to whooping my ass. I'm not on a first name basis with Chicago. Call her out her name and she brings out a belt or a paddle, cedar plank with a fist handle. Oak Park be an inattentive mother, doesn't check her kids when they're out past the length of a spanked ass. In Oak Park, the white kids say to their moms, "I hate you," and I flinch for them, expecting a flip-flop to erupt from a canvas bag, for the pigs to be called to stop the beatdown, watching for Chicago to pop the child's lip open with a swift backhand. But moms in Oak Park do nothing better than knit fury into a smile and a shrug of the shoulders. And Chicago must be face-palming in these times, asking how Oak Park could be a mother so terrible at being a mother, how Oak Park could be a mother willing to let her kids spit cantaloupe at her and call it sweetness, call it natural rebellion. Ain't nothing natural about the white boy who shows up to the last day of school with a do-rag and white beater on, says he wants to celebrate thug culture. The white sons of Oak Park call Chicago's name like they know her, like she owes them something other than a bopped head and a firework nose, like she isn't my granny, ready to string them to a flagpole by their Fruit of the Loom underwear, ready to run their hollow hay hair through a flat iron, send them back to their mother with switch burns in the back on the back of their wrists. If white boys ain't ready to drop a few teeth, then they shouldn't be holding my granny's leather belt of a name in their mouths. Thank you. So this next piece is called Negro Antics Week after Martin Espada. This be the week of the inhaler during recess, lungs of fumbling tissue. This be the week of consenting to hugs, to acerbates making a cheek fart. This be the week of the third son, staying awake in bed forming hand shadows and closet light. This be free of the crib, niggas. Find your dad sneaking brownies at night, niggas, with no dad to find sneaking niggas. This will be our week. Give that white boy a swirly week. Give your own hand a kiss week. This be no smoke week. This be cancel the cigarette neighbor's week. This be hand your mama the remote that's right next to her foot week. This be I fed my homework to the dog week. This be simple week. This be all hours. No need to call in sick for school week. This be self-care week. This be legendary Naruto marathon week. This be any time we want. And this week, the CTA will fold in on itself. The buses will not run and neither will we. And this week, be untouchable dance party on every block that ever looked at you upside down. All the whites will be confused. Look in their pockets and find scabs, find loose teeth, find a rippling stomach and other things they will want you to fix. But this week, you smack them translucent with your moving hips. And this week, we pay them nothing.
Hi y'all, my name is Anaya. I go by Naya. I live on Chicago's South Side, and I'm gonna do two poems for you. And the first poem, the title is Lake Michigan, July 27th, 1919. It is 96 degrees. Soon, tensions will boil you over, turn into black blood baking in the sun. Soon, you will know cold, even in the midst of a hot summer's day. James Crawford, come child, please. Eugene is okay. He is making a place for Emmett and Marsha and all the others who will be found in the water. Come, shed your skin. Up there, they'll hear riot and think you are the cause. You will fire, and instead of a hug or sorry for your loss, they'll leave you lip-kissing a land that never loved you. It is true. Black belt too tight to loosen, even in water. Invisible color line thinks the rock's the core. Too many tools up on shore for your undoing. And y'all think me one too. Think the job finished when the last air bubbles pop. But I have loved you since ships shed bodies touched my water and made a country out of me. They messed up thinking me a graveyard. Here, black folks seed, they plant and I take someplace better. I promise the deeper you go into me, the more you evolve. There is no need for breathing here. The sun visits us too. Even she is gentler to black than on surface. You are brown, and no one calls it dying. When you die here, you come back. James, if you must leave your house today, come straight to the water. Come home to me. Okay. The next poem I'm gonna do, the title is Chicago, a God Uncle Chris Chose to Give His Life to. I be having a hard time swallowing my spit. Okay. I love Chicago, so I married her. Got 39th Street tatted around my arm like a ring. I red line like ritual. I bleed mouth sauce. I walk inside the temple of a corner store and spend my last offering on the 2-liter RC. Chicago been home. Yeah. I watched them headlines shot a bullet hole Chicago's body into an exit wound. Scared mama into trying to push me out. Had to explain to her, Chicago and I got that old timers love. That if I died, then she died to be with me kind of love. for I know her history and she know mine. Gave me the whole South Side. Named me the king of Lake Michigan to keep boys from drowning. For I am the slick of the South Side. When I was sick, I coughed up the low end for my boys, looking for a way back to 511 East Browning. My black every pothole. My gap, a snapshot of the space the Wales Projects left behind. The hood is my whole world. The ashy, the only white I choose to see. My girl Chicago got a slick tongue, outside of state trying to claim. Got all these men she don't love blowing up her phone, trying to make a home out of her. She stopped texting niggas back, cause I'm her new favorite thing. She likes the way I mix gutter and worship in my mouth. I say, no nigga formed against me shall prosper. And the police think I'm talking about my niggas instead of them. The police tried to force me off my land, love me back real good. Chicago tells men how we pray to each other, and they throw rocks, spit at Chicago, and I forgive them, for they not know how to praise me right. They still looking at an invisible line, four directions.
Hi, I'm Sarah Kim. I'm from Oak Brook, Illinois. And this first poem is called Victory Vignettes, after Martin Espada. Victory means we run outside to play in the morning without brushing our teeth. We hit baseballs and kick hacky sack with pickled plums caught in our smile. We whisper yes to ourselves after we finally nail that Korean tongue twister about presidents of soy sauce companies or drawings of tall green giraffes. We are children of churchgoers, so fidgety we sit on floor cushions in the walkway of the pews. We are raised by doctors and lawyers, and we get so, so jealous of those with taekwondo masters for parents. Victory means we will never be able to choose just one favorite food. Mugwort syrup in our rice cakes on New Year's Eve. Spam in kimchi stew, the kind our soldiers used to cook and eat. Our fathers become our best drinking buddies. We tip back shots of soju swirled with pureed kiwi. Our moms are unafraid to say they love us in a silent bakery as we palm the loaves of milk bread. Victory means we lose or gain a pound. Victory means grandma loses her arthritis and regains her hair and spikes a volleyball at the beach. Our cousins, who are ambitious and long for the sun, will move to the East Coast and California for school. We do not strike back when hit. No one is watching us through the spout of our teapots. Grandpa might have a dream of encountering his long-lost brother on a bus or a nightmare, entertaining if he'd been a second too late crossing over. Savannah and Schomburg would never have been in his future. Just ankle clamps and electricity. We momentarily forget we might have relatives traversing the Gobi Desert, escaping the Northern regime. That for some of us, Los Angeles in 1992 should have never happened. For some of us, home is not even Chicago or Los Angeles, and certainly not anywhere overseas. We've lost our home like an earring, accidentally torn away by a rip current, and now the ocean gets to own an extra pearl. But we will never be far from home. We will take the sliced almonds out of our mango-shaved ice. We will reflexively put our fingers up into a V in the face of a camera. And we will come out beautiful if the gears and machinery can carve us in our own likeness. And a quick preface. This poem I wrote is about the apartment I stayed in during Bomb Squad. It was with my friend Vicky, and so I wrote it about their apartment. Because that's Chicago to me. I don't know about Chicago very much. Yes. Reading room. I am the eyes and horns of summer. I will burn in heaven like a Raphael painting. This is the Y2K bug I am. I am, I am, I am, I am. Storage. Jesus is a body pillow communing with passports. Behold, Holbein's dead Christ, blackened feet, extended middle finger. Death, where is your sting? I could sleep for 3 days if I could try it. I wear albatrosses like a noose, but I don't want eternal sleep. Kitchen, ketchup packets, hamburger buns, instant jello packets so recently expired, a Tupperware full of blueberries, no meals here. We have power outages and tap water. See me? Just say the word and I'll pay. Bathroom. Mathematics is a divine language. Archimedes deified in water. Eureka, I have discovered right angles. Vicky and Maurice, both of you swear that Gladys Knight has a voice made of lapis lazuli. Oh, to be a Motown gem. Ricky, apparently, LSD trip has two meanings. I know you hate my silent steps, but let me tag along. I have lots to learn. When you move, I mirror you, though I stumble too. Living room. I can't sleep in the dark. I've made new routines, like working and waking up at 5 every day in the morning without fail. Evolved. My body won't rise until the door yells goodbye after them. Coffee and coffee and coffee and coffee some more. Look outside. What's for dinner? Fireworks. Goodbye, goodbye, goodbye. Don't they build buildings so tall these days? Exit. Entryway.
Hello? Okay, I can hear myself. That's what matters. Hi, my name is Darion. I am from the south side of Chicago, specifically Auburn Gresham, specifically 76 South Bishop. And this first poem is called What Chicago's Been For Me. Chicago been seeing blue and red lights and knowing to take flight. Chicago's been 911, 911 what? Nigga, I'd rather keep my Glock 30 on speed dial. Forget a mask, that boy not gonna live to snitch or see trial. It's been translating PTSD through violent means, and since people of color aren't allowed to have mental illnesses yet, we'll footwork and juke jam in the meanwhile. Chicago's been a big gangbang, like CPS fucked me, CPD fucked me and cuffed me, Cook County Jail so backed up it likes to fuck me slow. When I think about the institutions who fucked me, that's really a question of who didn't. But at least Chicago wines and dines me at first with an Italian fiesta slice and a six-piece from Harold's Chicken. It's been gangbanging, like my flag is my address and my flag is my skin. Chicago told me if you don't look like me and you ain't from where I'm from, then we can't be friends, folks. We can't hoop over there. We intuit with them. I didn't know Spanish, but I knew hearing barrio and mayate in the same sentence meant, oh shit, here we go again. Chicago's been listening to drill music and feeling a sense of pride, knowing that a nigga that should have died from poverty, poor education, and being traumatized still has the ability to transcribe how we be feeling inside. Chicago's been happy to see that man still living, because where I'm from, even if you can't read, you still usually see a sentence. Because where I'm from, even if you don't know math, you still end up being a statistic. Chicago's been joyfully telling white people you're not allowed, from, and never will be on the nine. I think these white kids love drill music so much because they have something in them that just likes to hear niggas die. Chicago's been not allowing words to offend me. Because where I'm from, we don't have that kind of privilege. We have too much pain in us to really have feelings. We don't care about your words. We just try to read your intention. Chicago's been this white, weirdo, liberal agenda trying to befriend us with pretend love, trying to move up the social ladder with the power we give them. Send us back to the bottom we came from when they done. Every time one of us dies, they don't say none. We help all groups get to where they need to go and realize we ain't one. But they not really a fan, shit. You gotta have a MAGA hat like Kanye. Damn, they be the shade of chance to rap before they give one of us rappers a chance. Chicago been funny as fuck. Y'all put Larry Hoover in prison and Al Capone in history books. Chicago's been scared of us. They know what we would do if we was united, so they make barriers. We a problem for them. They divide us, so we take care of us. Chicago's been showing me the realities of America. This last thing is just about, I guess, gangbanging and how Chicago has a lot of racial gangbanging going on in the mind that a gang member or somebody goes through and they retaliate. I feel like I went on the other side, looking to avenge a friend of mine who had died. I left my mama's crib at exactly 8:45. I looked at my 15 little brothers and sisters. I said goodbye, blasting Phazo Land as I wide. White van gripping a black 45, radio blasting, 4-5 I'm gripping. Homicides on they sides because my side was tripping. Trying to catch one of them slipping. Repercussions, resolutions, through discussions, I didn't care because one of mine is finna equal two of theirs. Matter of fact, one of mine finna equal a few of theirs. Pull up to his address. Park, my G. We gonna wait. There's too many kids playing on the porch for me. 20 minutes of laying low, and lo and behold, there you go. And he say, how you know? That's a op, my G. I thought to myself, I know he one of them because he don't look like no lame. He walked like me. He dressed just like me. Crazy shit went through my mind. Had a bunch of brothers and sisters at his crib, just like mine. Stomach looked like ain't shit in his fridge, just like mine. Think how this nigga took one of his, but shit, I'm finna take one of mine. It felt like I was committing some weird form of suicide. It felt like I was looking for myself on the other side. Thank y'all.
Hey, y'all. My name is Crystal Mosley, and I'm from the South Side of Chicago, specifically the Beverly neighborhood. And this first poem is titled Water Fight. I want my people to drink more water. Not that dirty poison shit pouring and pumping lead out of decade-old pipes. I want my people to drink water from those fancy filtration facilities that washes away every microbe and plastic bead, water that could wash away the high blood sugar in my genes. We deserve water that's gone through leaps and bounds of alterations to fit us just right, whether we sell that loud, 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 or went to brown, brown, brown. I want y'all to stop thinking my people are afraid of water, water that you tried to keep us out of, pools you drain because Dorothy dipped her toe in, lakes you tried to draw a line through. Would I hear what Eugene was thinking as they smashed his brains out in 29th Street Beach? I want water to stop being converted into a weapon. Fire hoses used to spray down my people as they protested. Bodies of water made into a burial ground as my people were thrown overboard into the Atlantic. What if the current took my ancestors' souls and sailed them back to the motherland? If you look real close, can you see what was left of Emmett's face in the Tallahatchie? Why is there a desire to divide water? Who gave y'all the right to claim which molecules are yours? Water wasn't meant to be an accomplice in your hatred, a tool in your box used to tear us apart. It seems that you've forgotten water gives life, houses heartbeats. And for you to exploit its power and fight over which heart can and cannot beat in it goes to show how deep you'll go to make sure none of my people feel safe in or out the water. All right, y'all. This second poem is titled Red Line Unicorn. I hope you are. I saw a unicorn on the 95th Red Line station today. It was wearing a button-down polo, khaki shorts, New Balance sneakers, and Apple Watch, and the look on its face like it was ready to conquer the world. It must have not known where it was, prancing around with its $1,000 phone out, backpack unzipped, exposing its $2,000 computer, wallet, and swell water bottle. Man, in this fairyland, we take what looks like has no home. Its innocent smile and lack of a good ass-whipping face stood out from the deep eye bags, drooping cheeks, cracked working hands, eternally hunched back of someone's granddad, and the gold chain slanging, dream chasing, G Herbo praising, Giovanni reading, anywhere but here going grandchildren. I wonder if the fenders and May eyes, booming stereos and sirens, will scare that unicorn off. Will its innocence get it robbed? Will the unicorn adapt to the climate? Or will it take a challenge, find an opportunity zone, kick out grandpa and the grandkids, and make a unicorn colony? Thank you.
Hey, y'all. I'm Morgan Varnado, and I'm from Oak Park. And this first poem is called Oak Park Takes a Nap and the Niggas Sneak Past. It's about my neighbor's dog who hates me. The dog next door isn't dead yet, and I don't know if it wants to be this time. It sleeps against our fence post like a pile of damp straw. He too old to bark at us now, or at least when he does, we confuse it for the dirt scraping under our shoes, small whiffs of a lighter that never catch a spark. He swears he'd bite our legs off if we wasn't so far away. He swears he'd make us kindling in his teeth if his stomach had more of itself to burn. You niggas is firewood, he says, and I'd make my mouth an oven if I hadn't already sat down. And this fence post wasn't so comfy, and I wasn't already tumbling into sleep. Thank y'all. And this next poem is a persona poem somewhere during the war. It's something in that damn song Billy sang last night. Something in it keeps me trudging forward. Can't you hear it now? Thumping over cannon fire and the thick mud of dying men. I can hear him singing loud. Kill, kill, kill. Though it echoes different. It echoes like my mama filing a stiff thread through the final hole of a button. Or my pops thunking his last nail into the fence's stubborn head. Kill, kill, kill. Though I don't remember Billy's song holding such words. Honest, I don't remember Billy's song having any words at all. Something about it just spoke. Under the big hands of yesterday's campfire, Billy thudding his bare feet into the dirt just in front of his stump. Something in the way he was humming, a half-struggling song, pulling itself out from between his teeth, his head jerking toward the sky, past the weave of branches that made up the forest, hollering names he used to know, old loves he had before the fighting, ghosts his heart knew before his neck met the pestering cold we all got used to carrying. Kill, kill, kill. Can't you hear it? Over the thuds of men folding into dirt. Kill, kill, kill. Over the roars of gunfire erupting like train smoke. Kill, kill, kill. Endless, rising above the battle, far past the reach of trees, deep into the howling face of the sky. Thank you.
Hello? All right.
Hello. Hello.
Make some more noise for Bomb Squad. Woo! Such good, good poems. I'm so proud of all of you. I understand you went to the Newberry Library to look at some artifacts to get inspired for this reading today. The first question I wanted to ask you guys was just like, were there any artifacts in particular that stood out to any of you that you wanted to talk to us about?
Thank you. At the Newberry Library, there's this one old poster for, I forget which war, either the First World War or the Second World War, either one of the two. And it was a propaganda poster to get black people to enlist in the army. And it was like, the colored man is no slacker. And it had like this photo of a black army officer with his wife and then a bunch of black people marching in the background and an American flag. And it was next to some old like Southern style pillars and flowers and all that stuff. And it was very flowery and like very like, hey yo, we want you to fight for us and join the army. And it's just sort of like, it's kind of conflicting. It made me think about war and violence and sort of like how they wanted black people to join the army in order to fight for America. But then, you know, with the race riots, literally with that poster, like a black soldier versus like a white man with a gun, it's sort of like, it's like the violence sort of never stops. Just the thing that switches is who they want you to kill or who you have to kill. And in this situation, it was some rough. So yeah.
I was about to say about that exact same thing. Like, I'm so glad you brought that up. That bothered me so deeply, bro. Like, I've also, no, real rap, I feel like that and another artifact stuck with me so much, but that stuck with me so much because every single time I look at propaganda that's trying to throw black bodies in between what's usually a white issue, it's just like, I tend to not even think about like how most people see, like, what? This is stupid. But there are people that like listen to that. I feel like it's a lot of people that get tired of the struggles and strifes that come with being black, and they'll look for anything to escape that, and they end up between a war between two people that don't even see them as human. And that artifact, like, when I saw it, it's crazy because it's like, damn, this is, what I'm thinking of right now is like how that go on today, but like that's going on back then. And even what he said, like, it's lit, like, that's, I can't, that picture describes it so much, like, that's the reality of it. But that image and that propaganda tried to say that that's not the reality. That stuck with me.
Yeah, what they mentioned about the poster, everything was spot on. Very, you know, it's a huge juxtaposition of domesticity and, you know, the violence that followed after. But what I wanted to talk about was the newspapers. They had newspapers out during the time of the race riots. And if you go to the Newberry Library and look at those artifacts, something very interesting is that the race riots are never the front page story of the event. They're never the headlining story. And I think that kind of shows how back then, you know, racial tensions, even when Chicago in 1999, they were steeped in these racial tensions and, you know, violence was reaching like its peak and all of that. It never, you know, in the newspapers, it never seemed to be the headlining issue, which just kind of shows how avoidant people were of addressing this issue. And I feel like that kind of sentiment is something that even now America is still trying to get over, and we're trying to find better way, or not necessarily better ways, but how we can make, you know, the conversation about addressing racial tensions a little bit more accessible and something that shouldn't be, you know, that we shouldn't be avoidant to. And yeah, that really surprised me because, you know, local news is supposed to report local news, but they will never, you know, in those magazine articles, it's always, oh, you know, people like writing letters asking for advice, or the headlining story is about like the murder of, you know, some little girl, you know, out in like wherever in Illinois. But it was never about like the racial tensions and the race riots, which I thought was very jarring, first of all. And yeah, my initial reaction was just like, why are they not talking about it?
Wow, thank you. thank you, Sarah, for kind of segueing us into our next question. I'm also thinking about the newspaper headlines that you guys saw, and I'm wondering what the rest of you think and what the rest of you notice about the headlines, and with that, what parallels could you draw between those headlines and the way that media reports on racial violence today?
Okay. I would say that today, it's this ain't nothing new but a flu. Like, it's the same thing. It ain't really changed. Like, no, like, real rap, it's the same thing. I think that it pays to be fake, and it was true back then, it was true right now. I don't think the news, for one, I don't think that the news today reports on things that happen the way they should, because I don't, if you put reality in a lot of people's faces, I think it'll cause a lot of problems. And two, I think, just to be completely 110 with you, I think some problems that should be reported won't get reported because the people that's gonna be seeing it ain't gonna care. If Like, for example, we all in this room right now know that race is a real issue in America, right? Really speaking, it damn near should be on every news tabloid every day, like how serious of a problem it is. But I feel like if you throw that issue in a lot of people's faces, it's like, oh, come on, man, I'm trying to enjoy the Bears game. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't, like, it's the same thing. It's the same, just them headlines is fake, because fake gets you paid. In reality, you know, it don't stick to people. People don't want to face reality and do something about it.
I would definitely agree with Darion on that point. I think the biggest thing that stuck out to me about the newspaper articles was just the economy of it, and thinking about who is behind the newspaper in the first place, and really just like who is making the money off of it. And it's one of those things where it's like, if we share the story about the race riots, is this going to make us more money, essentially? Which just comes to a whole other thing about just like, I don't know, the monetization of people of color and just like the monetization of our struggle and also our success. And what's gonna sell the most paper and what's going to bring the most recognition to us. And I feel like that was what was really just blowing my mind still to this day. And so like when you see stuff on the news today, there's so much that isn't mentioned because it's, as Darion said, like people are not going to necessarily care about that, especially since it's talked about, but it's not really seen or really addressed in a more human way and really bringing humanity to the people that are dying and are involved. So yeah.
Thank you.
So I just want to say, this is the same racism, just a different decade and different location. Because we like to think of the North as being not as racist or as discriminatory as the South. However, what happened to Eugene Williams just goes to show you that it was the same hatred going on. And they didn't care, obviously, because they never made a major issue in the newspapers because they didn't care. This was maybe not an everyday, but it wasn't important to them because they didn't see black people as being important.
Thank you guys so much. Can we give another round of applause for these poets from Boston? And then let's keep that applause going for the next six poets from Bomb Squad. Thank you guys.
Cool. There it is. Hey, how y'all doing? My name is Jerome. I'm from the south side of Chicago. And I'm going to do a few poems with you guys. And the title of this first piece is America Never Was America to Me. When my AP Human Geo teacher came to school with the Make America Great Again button pinned to his chest, I couldn't help but question it. Wonder what America he's seen. Wonder what greatness he refers to. He says, well, aside from, you know, the whole racism thing, this country was once a great industrial powerhouse. And I get it. Slogan turned sales pitch, promise of perfection for the majority allures you. You are fed a dream, told this land is yours to feast, so eat, reap and sow your bearings. I was raised on a diet of warnings. Told this country sees us as lamb to sacrifice or token for blessings. Told this country lines its pockets with boys that look like me, builds foundations with our bones and act like we don't belong here, like this country ain't been built on sable backs, like black ain't been their favorite currency, like we ain't been getting the lowest means of survival, but yet are still expected to survive. Like, we don't deserve your dream. I want America. No, scratch that. I want to make America the promise it was meant to be. I want to erase the strikes from my birth certificate. I want this skin to not mean second-class citizen. I often imagine that America for my little sister. The America where she only writes happy poems because her people aren't being over-policed or marginalized. Her people aren't made martyrs. An America not of equality, but equity. An America without a clown for a president. An America where the worry for next meal disappears for everyone. Poverty goes poof. Displacement is a myth, and black people, not just black trends, matter in my America. White people are as tired of racism as we are. This America is all inclusive. No need to march in my America because you already matter here. Uncle, this America isn't greedy. Uncle Sam ain't stuffing us in projects and forgetting about us no more. In my America, all young minds are worth investment. And the skeletons of old schools are renovated and repopulated. Even let the students redecorate. Watch them watch murals across old dusty bricks to create something new. Call it an American dream based in the hood. Less penitentiary fenced in, more hopping picket fences at grandma's, more cookout and unity. In my America, you black child are bulletproof. And you aren't running from badge or brother, because here, 18 is a birthright and not a blessing. Here, culture is thriving, love is possible between all barriers and divides. Here, America is America for everyone. And this second poem is titled, "The White Gaze Can Make Monsters Out of Any of Us." They fear your teeth, boy. Your smile sharpened ivory, boy. Your skin rough as shea butter, boy. Don't you know they trophy case wild heads like you? Stuff cotton, a comfortable laugh between your jaws. You're the monster on the mantle, boy. You catch the finger, for the act is even done. Boy, they see you. Eyes as glassy as the ceiling. What I tell you about flying too close to the sun? What I tell you about Icarus, about Emmett? You won't learn till they teal your ass too. Turn your bronze rubber skin to a leather they can claim. Either wear you mane or make you rug, boy, they see you. Culture commodity enough to costume in. All prey and predators wool, they see your soft hands. Meat cleaver calm. Make murderer out of the same palms your mother used to pour molasses into. They hear your snarl for help. A blood-curdling, gummy growl, tongue sharp as sunflowers, boy. Don't you know there's nothing more dangerous in this world than a scared white man? And I wish I could tell you how to act accordingly. But I don't know what that looks like when your existence is the threat, but boy, I see you. Predestined predator before your lips even part. Born the thing that goes bump in the night. Boy, I see you in all your beauty, labeled a beast.
Okay. How y'all doing today? That's great. My name is Nyla Foster. I'm from the south side of Chicago, far south side, Roseland area. Oops, my bad. And I'm gonna do this first piece for you guys. It's basically about getting on the bus when it's really late and everybody just looks really tired, including you. It's called "The Last Bus Stops Running at 11. When the sun goes down, we are speedy snails slugging our bodies, yearning for our feet to unite with our porch steps. We leave a slimy trail of sweat that slips from the creases of our foreheads that work gave us. With the droop of daytime comes the drip of the corners of the bus driver's mouth, how his face sags down to the soles of his shoes like jean back pockets that dwell behind knees, how denim dangles on the Dan Ryan's thighs like dreads. I think the 115 waits for me at 95th. Faces, jeans, hair, ambition, all sagging, gather on this bus in a cluster, and we are falling fireworks to sink further south into the city like mother's breast in a spaghetti strap. We are all floor huggers, weep like willows and wilt in Chicago. in Chicago's cool night heat. At 10 p.m. on the 115, it is finally okay for black folk to be dead white light, falling stars onto Earth's surface. Thank you. My bad. And this second piece is entitled For My People. slightly inspired by Eugene. Whenever I perform a poem, my people praise it in hallelujahs and amens and tongue talk. Put me on a pedestal. Say, with this platform I got, I best use it for good storytelling and to die for performances. I only know how to use this stage to resurrect the grandmother I never met and dance with her, hands and minds. Her fingers still oily from the fried green tomatoes from before. These poems had the chance to suck the cancer out. Use this stage for poems that empty churches into open mics so they may see it is the same thing. Have my people find God in these poems. This stage be a pit of fire and I a stick of sage. Poems be an ancestral hotline. Whenever I perform, it is a call to update them on how the movement is going in hopes to give them something to be proud of. Write poems to be proud of, poems that can drain the lake of dead bodies and wash the blood off the rocks. Poems be a life raft that floats down a southern river that migrate the whole Chicago back into a small Mississippi backyard. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kyla Pareles, and I'm from Oak Park. And this first poem is called Death Reminds Us We Are Puerto Rican. You are only allowed to be mine if you are cousin and aunt at once, if you carry knives to funerals, you kiss the noses of the dead, take pictures of the body with the flash on and use it as a postcard. You are mine if you are great uncle who will see 106. When the nurse drops you, you call her pendeja. You promise death doesn't know how to laugh like you do. You are mine if you are great aunt who could only make it to 67. If you were strong for your nieces for all those years and never spoke about the time your coworker was shot in front of you. You are mine if you are grandmother. If you sell your mother's house because all the tidados are dead. If you are misplaced in your family, if you are dutiful when no one gave you a reason to be, you are a grandfather whose half-siblings never told you your dad died, if you read poems at graves, we carry our flag like it houses our dead. It seems now the island is its own graveyard. My mother told me how many Taínos the Spaniards killed, how our warrior ancestors were massacred. I think that's where our obsession with death comes from. When we bury one of us, we remember there's only so much warrior left. But we are still Taíno, still carrying our knives and our poems, and we are breathing. And who would we be if we didn't fight? We wait to hear the sound of the coqui, our battle cry. It screeches into the night. You are mine. And then this next poem is called Oak Park Mutter Statistics. In this chunk of non-city, the people are proud of their diversity, even as the achievement gap at my high school glares at them. So I decide to Google the statistics. I find population divided by male and female, 47% to 53%. Then I find the median age, 39.5 years. The estimated household income, $87,400. Lastly, I find the percentage of residents living in poverty, 8.5%. Then I see in parentheses, 6% for white residents, 9.6% for Hispanic residents, 14.3% for black residents. The page mutters numbers to me sheepishly, pushing them all the way to the bottom. I wonder why it was the poverty statistic that mentioned race, when on the whole page it didn't even list the total racial makeup of Oak Park. Then I remember everything is about money. That in this cushy suburb, racial bias loves to glare back at you from the inside of a wallet. As the Chicago Tribune covered the riots in 1919, it was overshadowed by the streetcar strikes, the white people inconvenienced as they had to find other ways to get to work. I bet no suburban wife looked towards the lake and saw black bodies. She only muttered about the value of her house. I wonder, have suburban women ever done anything other than cast problems under their bottom lip, let injustice sit with their stale breath, their hate has no home here lawn signs sit freshly in their trimmed grass, and I can feel it sigh at me as I walk past. Do the women lie awake at night and think about how my parents have never owned a house, or will they grumble in their sleep about the cost of gymnastics? In Oak Park, is Oak Park the cut lawn, the sign planted in it, or the white woman proudly standing on her meaningless morals? Where does it fit in a world that would rather focus on anything other than the problems next to us? I just hope that when Oak Park makes its choice, it will say it without muttering.
Hi guys, my name is Jonquil. Everyone calls me JoJo, and I'm from the south side of Chicago. Yes, that's where I'm from. I'm be sharing two pieces with y'all today. The first one is entitled, "The Ancestors Have Returned as Seeds for the Race War," after "Imagine the Angels of Bread" by Martin Espada. Anyway. Hiding in creeks, over in the corners, under the bus, in the classroom, jumping out of books, launching into intercoms, on the way home with you, easing you into bed, so you may never wake again. Take your children's children, grands and greats too. Kill them with silence. Kill them in silence. You'll never see it coming. Ignorance will evaporate like water. Take racism and discrimination and homophobia with you. You'll never see it coming. See, these seeds can lift 100 times their weight. Throw you over the bridge, launch colonization into the waters, lift every dead body out of it. See what it feels like. Drown in ignorance, suffocate in abundance of hatred. We're back, squatters, refugees, dark-skinned men, immigrant birth, Emmett Till, Eugene Williams. We're taking it all back, planting a new lifestyle. From the ashes and the waters, we will rise. So yeah, that was my first piece. The next piece is entitled "Chicago Summers" with Raquel, which is my little sister. Aww. Imagine if, before you could talk, you're percolating. Came out of the womb pop locking dropping, splits with your sister, bobbing, hunts you from the kitchen on Sunday morning with stank breath and ragged hair, all the way to block club parties with Uncle Farley as the DJ. You are the Golden Girls, a name that shines brighter than your hair and eyes. You can percolate your way into splits just as fast as people can walk or run or footwork their way to the dance floor. Percolating is second nature. Not pushing or pulling or moving your chest to the beat, but clashing one hand to the other, pushing them against each other like gangsters at war. It begins to automatically move your chest as one leg spreads from the other end to the floor to the other. And Unc Farley is screaming to the beat, "I heard you say," and you and your sister Raquel respond, "Hey, hey," and you look each other in the eye. As the beat is mixing, you are on the floor. One leg is meeting the other from that end of the room to the middle of your toes, grasping your sister's hand, jumping with enthusiasm, ready for another round. At juke jams, y'all compete against the other girls for chimp change. The rules are, you get one song request. You and your partner, the dynamic duo, dances their heart out, and each earns $5. Raquel turns on the music. It's always house music. and you guys are always in some, on a dance floor, or in someone else's kitchen, or basement, or backyard, and they don't never know what's coming next. Between y'all's cheerleading background, and backflipping, and splits, and Unc Farley, the house music king, they never know what's coming. The ops at the time, playground buddies, hiding seekers, cops, because y'all were always the robbers, were always robbed of their $5.
What does it do with this? Oh, sorry. That's a little loud.
It's a little high, but thank you. Okay. Hi, my name is Penelope. Thank you. I'm going to read two poems for you all today. This first one is called, "This Time I Treat Rachel to Dinner." And she doesn't get a plus one, which means she can't drag her toddler or silver cross stroller into the restaurant. Not that Rio's de Sudamerica would let her. I've bribed David and every waiter to make my mom's ex-boss fidget. They will flake hot rocoto powder on the pudding, squeeze lime into her water until she cringes and an eyelash unhooks. I want her mascara to drip, her blush to melt into my chicken caldito, which means I want to eat her like my birthday. Cake because my mom... Cake my mom missed because she worked late. Or the gourmet penne a la vodka Rachel paid for when she left for Minnesota. What good are my mom's diaper hands when there are no toddlers to change? How much will her skin roughen without washing Rachel's clothes with fabric softener? David says he doubts the sous chef will perform cannibalism, but he can try. By the time her Sudan rolls into Bucktown, I've inhaled all of the ají criollo she scoops with her tortilla chips. Now she wants a napkin to spit in, or a sink. David wants to show her the bathroom for the tablecloth's sake. But I say no. Every waiter says no, which means she must force the burn down her throat. And she does. She does. She does. Cool. This next one is actually inspired by, where is she? Kyla and her poem. Okay, yes. Cool. The women in my family are hairy. Sorry, Mom. Okay. If the falling thickness covers the bathroom tiles, a threaded rug, you are mine. Only if your hair clogs the shower drain. Only if the razor doesn't scrape past the knee. All the women in my family shed their wool except in January. A second coat for every time the generator busts its heat. Hair for nights the lovers pull all covers to the left side of the bed. You are mine if your legs stretch for miles under fur canopy. I will claim you. Fuzzy, you will belong when you rub your arms against mine and I feel prickled by cacti. I don't want glossy magazine limbs. No waxed aftertaste can glow like my mama's whiskers in orange sun. My aunt's hairy knuckles knocking the kitchen door down is the only hymn calling my name on Sundays. If you answer to the scraping of razor cleaning, I don't have anything to run my hands through. Instead, a strip of mowed grassland I never learned how to kiss hello on the cheek.
Let's go!
Oh my God. Hey y'all, I'm T. Thank you. This first piece is basically how I
often feel in white Chicago. After the only black carving on the wall tells me my face isn't just a wall, my body is a mansion. The only nigga on the wall almost blends in too well, must have been a good nigga, too good of a nigga to not be treated, like the rest must have been a snitch or a house. Nigga earned his spot, rightfully who am I to talk? Maybe he was the sacrifice fly, the wall knower, head of the rebellion, killer of white. Secrets be too sacred for him not to listen. White whispers through his walls, so he must have been a house, body a mansion, or maybe just dead. Couldn't print him on a t-shirt, so they carved him, here engraved on a wall paid. Respects to my nigga, provider of home, didn't even know he was the home. Even when they burnt him down and rebuilt him sturdy, the second time started making fires himself, started fires in single rooms. He said he likes the burning sensation, cools the fire that comes from white men's smoking rooms. Wonder if he ever gets to move around comfortably, if his shingles ruffle every time the Nickersons invite guests over, if his marble palms itch every time Richard auctions off a piece of him, if his hair sways just like peacock. Wonder how he lives, wonder why he lets them live inside him, leaving their smuck-filled fingerprints all over his walls. And that's that piece. The second piece is titled, After My Son Got Stabbed and Drowned in His Own Blood on the Last Night of the Riots. Now we do nothing but listen here and make and die and try to live longer and everything and nothing, I feel nothing. And to feel nothing is live now. Empty holds my skin in mannequin position. Wonder when he'll let go. Let me melt away into the lake with my boy. Let me swallow the body of Eugene. Maybe I can pick up my boy too. Maybe then they'll be able to swim freely and refill my empty in the process. Him and my boy both knew each other. Maybe that's why they died the same. Both drowned in some way. I wish I would have taught my boy to swim, stitched a lifeguard to his pocket, fed him life rafts after dinner as a midnight snack. Then he could have given a piece to the Williamses boy. Just let me wilt away in this room until my boy grows again in his new life. Thank you.
Wow, you guys, you are so good. I am really going through it right now because you guys are just so good. But I have questions for you guys. I'm really wondering if you guys were taught anything about the 1919 race riots in school.
Okay, so I was taught nothing about the 1919 race riots in school. I had to research it on my own, like I have to research most of my history, especially if I don't want to learn from a whitewashed textbook. It was just really coming up with this, like, I first researched it a couple years ago, but I had to reintroduce myself to it once we went to the library, and it was just really interesting seeing all the artifacts, because it was just seeing the disregard for black people and seeing how in the headlines, it would be a section about the race riots and the rest would be about a serial killer at that time who was killed this white lady named Jane. And it was just like, okay, Jane died and all these black people died too, so what's up?
Briefly, we got like a mini unit, but it's like, it was given to us like the rest of like the black history. I feel like, I don't know, schools are just real good at teaching black death and nothing else. So, yeah, it was like maybe a chapter in a book, and the rest was like us researching and going to like the library and going to see all the artifacts. So, yeah.
I have never heard of the race riots of 1919 until I took a field trip with my apprenticeship with Bomb Squad, and even then it was still narrated in a white voice. So, I mean, hey, get what you can get, but I have never heard of it, not in school or, and yeah, that's it.
Yes. Anyway, you guys basically said what I was gonna say. Like, I've never heard of the Chicago 1919 race riots. If we talked about it in school, like, it wasn't called like race riots. They didn't forefront it as what it actually was if we were taught in school, which is why I never like remembered it as like, oh, this was the 1919 race riots. This is what we went through, this, that, and the third. I was just like, oh yeah, this is something that happened in history, but it's not never something that was like intentionally taught to teach us to learn from our past or to learn from our history. And when things aren't intentionally taught, this is why we come from, like, this is like how we become such an ignorant America and stuff like that, which is really like nerve-wracking, because if we were just taught it in schools, it would solve so many other problems. Yes, I probably had something else to say, but I don't remember. No, I don't.
I think also, like, thinking about who is teaching, like, I know Jerome, in your poem, you was talking about the guy, the teacher with the Make America Great Again pen. I remember that, I know the teacher you're talking about. I'm like, I don't know if I would have wanted to learn about it from him, because he is one of the history teachers, right? So just also thinking about the lens in which that stuff comes through, especially in CPS schools. I guess I'm wondering from y'all right now, do you think that something like the race riots of 1919 could ever happen again anytime soon?
Okay, I'll just answer and send it this way, okay, guys? I think for sure it could happen again. It was on the verge of happening. It was during the school year when old dude, Van Dyke, whatever his name wasn't about to get locked up. Like, white people thought we were playing. No, like, we were not playing. The Black Panther movement and all of that, it's always been stopped because white people are afraid with what will happen when we do equalize our America, equalize our land, equalize like our opportunities and what's going on in the world. White people are always like, oh no, what's gonna happen next? Like, no, like, I'm going to die. But anyway, but it could happen again, because all the same things that were happening in 1919, all the same things that were happening during the civil rights movements are still going on today, and they're also still being brushed under the rug. And if they're not being brushed under the rug, they're being taught by these white teachers who are kumbaya people and like believe that there could be a change one day, but like they don't actually look forward to that one day. They're just like, they have so much white guilt within them that they want to make a change, but they don't necessarily look to like what that change would look like. And unfortunately, it would look like a riot, because there's lots of things that are still going on that black people and people of color are really upset with, because we've always been handed the wrong cards within our playing games, and we've just been sick and tired of it. So for sure, it could happen. And
you ready to pop out?
I agree. I definitely think that it could definitely happen again, because the same events are just happening in a different way. I feel like nothing has disappeared, it just evolved. And it's just, everything is a continuous pattern and it's not gonna go away. And sometimes rioting is the only way that white people will listen. And if that's what it comes to, then.
I myself am a very strong believer of, if you,
wait, chill, no, I wasn't even gonna talk about that, wow.
I was just a strong believer of, if you, history will repeat itself if you don't teach it. So if you don't know it, it's gonna happen again, and it may happen in a different form. Even if you do teach it, it still might happen again, I don't know. Especially if you don't teach, just
the consequences of it, but I never heard of the 1919 riots. And have I thought about a riot? No, not really, kind of, a little bit. So I do think it's definitely like a possibility. I just feel like it's definitely a possibility. Like how JoJo was talking about with the Van Dyke trial, like I was definitely upset and I definitely felt the anger, and I felt the anger of everyone in me. So like, how does everyone else feel, if that makes any sense?
Yeah, everything I was gonna say has pretty much been said, but like, I will hope it wouldn't happen again, for obvious reasons, but like, there's still that huge like fear of equity and like a huge fear of just like equal treatment and sharing the same spaces and coexisting. And it's just like, it only serves one point, which is just like ignorance and ego and ownership. It's like the whole, like the Eugene situation, the invisible race line, you feel me? Like ownership of a beach over something, over land that's been here before you, you feel me? It's just gonna be that. And until that fear goes away, until everyone's okay with everyone existing and being them without like them assimilating to fit your likeness, ain't nothing gonna change.
I would just like to say that almost all the riots I've learned about, and this riot too, it's always white people starting them. People of color minding their business, not doing anything, and then it's always a white person who just starts attacking. And I think that especially within the last, I think, several weeks of this summer, with the amount of mass shootings that we've had, it's not out of the picture to think that some white person would just come up to somebody who's minding their business and start attacking them, and that could spiral or tailspin. Like, it is within the possibility, because it is still happening. Like, I think about the LA riots, which weren't that long ago, and so it's just like, to happen in Chicago seems too close for me to like feel comfortable about it.
Thank you guys so much for coming. On your way out, donate some money to these wonderful, wonderful poets. Give them a round of applause one more time. And some words from Jamila.
Thank you so much. My name is Jamila Woods. I'm the Associate Artistic Director of Young Chicago Authors. Can we make some noise for Pat and Kara for hosting? Before we let you all go, we just wanted to say a few words about Young Chicago Authors. Thank you so much to the Newberry and to Harold Washington Library Center for hosting us. We really believe in giving young people a platform to express themselves, and I'm really happy that you got to see that tonight. I really don't like it when people are like, young people's voices matter because children are the future, because it implies that they don't have very brilliant and important thoughts to say right now. And so I'm happy that this event was put together for us to hear that. So just to reiterate, this group is called Bomb Squad, and if you like what you heard tonight, we host the largest youth poetry festival in the world. It's called Louder Than a Bomb every February and March. And we also have a space in Wicker Park where we have free programming. Every Tuesday is a free open mic. We also have a summer camp called Write to the City every summer. So please check out our website, youngchicagoauthors.org, for more info. And follow us on the socials, because there's a recap of tonight's event on our Instagram, Young Shy Authors, or we're Young Chicago Authors on Twitter. So thank you.